What's up, guys? I'm trying to pin right now. Hold on. How do I pin? I think I just pinned. I don't know. Hold on. Okay, got it. Hi, guys. How are you? Legendary Damon in the building. I am doing my legendary talk tonight. Very excited. We have Jessica Rosenblum tonight, a major icon in the industry. I'm very excited to talk to her. And, you know, yay. She is just been a major force in New York City nightlife culture for many, many years, and I'm excited to chat with her about her experiences and, you know, just talk. I do this legendary talk 7 nights a week. It is basically, you know, I talk to my cool friends about music and culture. And, you know, it's a very exciting thing for me. I get to celebrate these people that have influenced me, some of them. You know, some are from different genres, different eras. Ooh, AJ Calloway, what's up? Just explaining to people a little bit about Jessica Rosenblum, legendary Jessica, also legendary AJ. AJ, you'll have to come on here one time and do this with me. We basically talk about, you know, New York in the 90s and 2000s, something I know that you know a lot about. Yes. What's everybody drinking? And how's everyone doing? What's up, guys? Just joining. We are... AJ, you're not that old. Yeah, exactly. Neither am I. I'm 29 on Instagram. What's up, Megan? Vodka. What are you guys drinking? Vodka. Exactly. AJ, hope you're well. Best to you and your family. Your beautiful kids. Waiting for Jessica. So yeah, guys, just so you know, Jessica Rosenblum has been, you know, a very important person to culture, but to the, you know, New York City nightlife culture. And I am very excited to chat with her. Yeah, my favorite roommate, almost roommate. No, thank you. You're drinking rum, that's great. Tell them about your favorite almost roommate. Well, that would be a lie because it was not my favorite, so. But what year was that, AJ? That was like, I think 96, 97? I don't really remember. Actually, I remember, AJ, we should talk because I remember you telling me Lauryn Hill was making that album. You told me that in New Jersey. Lauryn Hill was making her album. And I was obsessed with Little Kim at the time, AJ, remember? What's up, Crazy Legs? Oh, 97, exactly. You were telling me about Lauryn Hill making the album, I remember. And then I was obsessed with Little Kim. And obviously, we know that famous Erykah Badu story, AJ, which you love telling. What's up, Alma? Alma told me today that she remembers meeting me exactly when she met me. I don't remember at all, but she said she vividly remembers it, and she wants to know my story. And I said, she's a writer. I said, let's write it. You can show the pic. What's up, Josie? Yeah, Alma, let's write my story. I'm not a writer, obviously. I have three different drinks. Very perceptive, Ralphie. I do like a white wine and a green tea and some water. What's up, Jean-Michel Cassavac in the building. He peeped me wearing his shoes on my Instagram yesterday. It was a picture from 2 years ago, and they were custom Jean-Mi shoes, so shout out to him. That tastes good. Allison, how are you? Gingy, what's up, guys? We're waiting for Jessica, legendary Jessica Rosenblum. I'm excited because some people on here don't know her and don't know her story, so this will be exciting for me. Well, for both of us, her too, hopefully. I've been trying to get her on here for, I think, 3-4 weeks. Oh, there she is. Perfect. Hey, Jess. Hey, Erica. Yes, Jessica is a classic. Like a Chanel bag. Oh, Jess is joining now. Hey, Carla. What up?
Hi.
Hey, Jess, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good.
I'm, you know, not super high tech over here, so I'm trying to figure out a little setup so I can put my phone down and really chat. How's that?
Good. Sit down, yes, and just prop it up against something.
Yeah, I have it, but I think it's weird. How's that? Better?
Yeah, that's good.
Good? There. How's that?
That's good.
Okay.
Move this way a little bit more. Yeah.
Well, I was trying to block this light. You know, it's very important, the lighting. We got to get this shit right.
And then maybe take an inch back.
How's that?
That's perfect.
Okay.
So, Jessica, first of all, thank you for doing this. I've been courting it for 3 or 4 weeks, as you know, right?
You have.
And I know it's a strange time to, you know, do your hair and put on, you know, some earrings and things. So thank you. I really appreciate you doing it.
I'm so glad you noticed, because it is the first time I've done my hair or put on earrings in 2 months.
Well, Khalees was on about 2 weeks ago, and she literally hit me 5 minutes before, and she goes, do I have to put on earrings and lipstick? And I was like, yes.
Yeah.
I mean, so, first of all, it's me. Come on. You know, how rude to not. I mean, okay, so you've seen the show. There's a couple people on here, maybe they're not really familiar with it. You've seen it a few times, and thank you. I appreciate that. But basically, you know, I'm interviewing my cool friends about music and culture, but it's kind of taken its own, you know, a life of its own, because it has kind of shifted towards, like, specifically New York City in the 80s, 90s, and really 80s and 90s, you know, and kind of, yeah, like, celebrating these extremely important people that I think are extremely important to culture. I'm getting to celebrate, which is, you know, to me, there's only a handful of people that actually, in New York City, that actually did really shift and were very important, really did shift the culture, and you're definitely one of them. So, you know, do you think that about yourself, or, like, how do you feel when I say that?
I'm just going to tell you one thing before we start talking about that. If you hear some strange noises in the background, everybody listening, keep in mind I own 2 bulldogs and they are, like, lurking around my feet, and they, you know, so it might sound like there's very odd activities going on, but in fact, it's just Sunday and Lily snorkeling and truffling around nearby.
They love you. They're circling your feet.
Yes, they are. They're here to listen, because they don't usually hang out in this part of the apartment, and they both came over once I requested to be in, so they're definitely paying attention.
Okay, so talking about back in the day, they want to hear it.
Yeah, like, right. Like, so your question: do I think that I affected or changed or moved along the culture?
Yes.
In the 80s and 90s, yes, definitely.
Okay, good. Because what I'm finding is that I would say it's like 50-50. Because I've interviewed, I think, you know, a few other people that I consider extremely influential and important to culture. And some of them want nothing to do with, say, no. So, yeah, what are you drinking?
Rosé.
Cheers.
Rosé. Come on.
Cheers.
I just opened it just for you.
I'm glad that you acknowledge it, because I think some people have either problem acknowledging or just don't even want to. So I'm really glad that you can do that. So,
well, I think, you know, I worked in two lanes that were very parallel and related to each other and helped each other, but they were two different worlds. So there was downtown and nightlife and everything that went with downtown, and then there was hip hop, and then there was bringing uptown downtown. But, and then, you know, where my involvement in hip hop progressed in terms of the music industry and a whole career in itself. But, you know, if we're going to talk about the beginning, the 80s and early 90s, it's really nightlife, but relating to both topics.
Okay, so I want to start.
Can I be like Dante and not let you get a single question in for like an hour and a half? That was so freaking epic.
But to be honest, the stories were great, and I was like, you know, like everyone else, I was just listening and watching, and actually enjoyed it. So
no, it was great. But everybody who knows him well was cracking up, because we were like, oh, David's not going to be able to say anything.
These deep stories, and I was trying not to laugh because the comments were so funny, you know.
Yeah.
So. Okay, so I want to start actually kind of like in the very beginning. So you're from New York, right?
My dad was born and raised in Brooklyn. My mom was born and raised in Greenwich Village. I was not born in New York. I was born upstate. And I grew up between Woodstock and Connecticut. and I ran away when I was 17 and moved to New York.
Got it.
I'd already been coming. I mean, obviously grew up coming here and always thought I would be in New York, and then started hanging out in New York when I was 14. I went to Studio 54 when I was 14.
Oh my God, amazing. I did not know that. It's so funny because everybody kind of from, let's call it your era versus my era, they're all saying they were going out at 14. It was like the common age to go out in New York at that time. You mean, my first job was at the Limelight when I was 18, and we were definitely letting 14-year-olds on there, for sure. That's true. I mean,
I hate to tell you, that was a long time after.
I know. I'm saying. But wait, so I want to start when you're growing up. So you're in Connecticut and upstate. And what's like your first, what are some musical influences, or what's the first song that you really remember connecting to as like an 8-year-old or a 10-year-old or something?
Well, I could tell you that the first piece of vinyl I owned was that weird French record, Samplon pour moi. I don't know why.
Which one?
It's called Samplon pour moi. Anybody who knows it will know what I'm talking about. It's a very strange thing. And Rod Stewart, Do You Think I'm Sexy? I don't know. These just happen to be the first pieces of vinyl I owned. Because ultimately I ended up having a huge vinyl collection for a long time. And then when that segued years later to managing DJs, it sort of felt natural. But when I was in high school, I had a radio show with a friend of mine, and we played Michael Jackson and Run DMC and trying to think, and a lot of new wave, Flash and things like that. And it was 83, 84, so in the middle of Connecticut. So that was kind of rad.
Yeah, because it's interesting too, because like I see the same kind of things coming up, is that people are saying like new wave was really, hip hop and new wave were kind of merged at that time, which is very interesting, like the early 80s. So
yeah,
very interesting. I don't think I knew that really, I mean, until I started doing this.
I think that, I mean, we're not going to do my life history the way Dante did his. I just got to rib him because it's fun. But I think relevant to your sort of direction that this whole thing has taken on, probably, and most people know me, my story really started to them when I was at the door at Nell's.
What was the first, and I want to get that in a second, but what was the first hip hop song that you remember ever?
It was whatever Run DMC records we were playing on the radio. It's 83, 84, whatever those records were.
Rock Box and stuff like that, probably, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so you moved to New York at 17, and who's your crew? Who's your gang? Like, what's going on? Where do you live?
I live in Hell's Kitchen. I lived on 55th and 10th.
Which was shady at the time, or how was it?
It was pretty dodgy. There was a reason it was called Hell's Kitchen.
Exactly.
But I had a cool as shit, like, railroad apartment around the length, like, it was narrow and ran the length of the building. It had a bathtub in the kitchen, like very classic. It was painted all white, the white loft. I knew a bunch of rich kids from the Upper East Side because I'd gone to boarding school, and I mostly hung out with them, and they were pretty wild and decadent, and most of their families were away for the summer, so it was just free for all. I was their like pet. I think it was so rad to them, like they're living in their families like Park Avenue Sevens, and I'm like in Hell's Kitchen, so I was like pretty entertaining to them. I think that was like the era of like maybe we're going to like Xenon and places like that, and Studio, and whatever, just hanging out. They were crazy. I mean, Upper East Side, we used to hang out at the Stanhope and have drinks. Like, that's pretty insane for a bunch of 17-year-olds. And towards the end of that summer, I met my boyfriend, and he was 5 years older than me, and he'd graduated from Harvard and was going to medical school. So I decided I should go back and finish high school, because it would be kind of a bad look if he was dating a high school dropout. So I was going to go back to boarding school, but I'd sort of been in not full trouble, but a little hot water there. So they told my parents that I could come back, but they would advise I become a day student, which was outrageous because it meant my parents had to buy me a car. My parents were very liberal and cool, artsy, whatever people said. And they were gone on the weekends because they were upstate. So there I was, boarding school as a day student, alone on the weekends with my own car. And my boyfriend, whose parents also went away, so we had an empty apartment on the Upper East Side. And we went clubbing every weekend in New York.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, it was like,
I'm like, so what is it?
That was sort of my early, And there's so many funny crisscrossovers. Everybody knows it's a world so small, you know, it's like a small planet. And so between who I'd gone to school with and who I knew from the summers, and, you know, it all started to sort of crisscross over and going out and going out. And at that point, we were just going to area all the time. That was the most important, coolest thing in the world.
And who was the door person? Do you remember?
There was...
Kenny or no?
Not yet. Yes. Maybe not maybe right away from the very beginning, but definitely yeah. Kenny, and that's where I know him from.
Yeah.
There was a guy named Michael who passed away, different Michael than the Michael who's with me at Nell's, who also passed away. I'm trying to think who else. I knew everybody. I was in, and that was our hangout spot, and we went to Madame Rose's too.
I've heard a lot about Madame Rose's as well.
Really bad with timelines, so bear with me, or it's just fine. Somebody correct me. Although I can't even read. I have a second phone here, so I can really see the comments, but I can't even read them.
Bill Spector said it was Gilbert. Well, I remember. I know Gilbert.
I don't think Gilbert at area?
And then
in the very beginning?
Dante said Daniel with the ponytail.
Yeah, I'm leaning towards that.
Okay, so but explain quickly, like, you know, describe area to me. I've never been. I'm obsessed.
Area was the most incredible, exciting club because this is before bottle service. This is before nightlife was about real estate.
Yeah.
In terms of, like, you know, being some rich guy to get hot girls buying something. So it was created by very creative people and it was for very creative people.
Yeah.
And so many things and genres were just starting to bubble. And whenever something's in the underground, but it's going to succeed, it's super exciting. So
yep.
You had musical genres that were bubbling. You had artists that were bubbling. You had gallerists, like everything. Anybody you want to talk about was there. Whether, it was the first unisex bathrooms and Keith Haring was there. That's where I met Michelle and Stuart Matthewman. I met a lot of people there. I met more people later at Nell's, but I was in area heavy. And yep. There was a lot of, it was the ultimate mishmash of people. So you had gay, straight, drag, trans, any, you know, race, sexuality, rich, poor, artists, whatever, banker, it didn't matter, but it was fun. And the thing is that, one thing that was the most amazing thing is there were all these windows, like store windows in the entranceway, and they were displays and they were installations, but they're really like art installations and they changed them every week, every month, there'd be a new theme. I mean, it was just fucking exciting.
And what year was that, like 86, 87 or something?
No, we're earlier because
okay.
I graduated, oh God, I hate you for this. I graduated from high school in 84.
Sorry.
So this is around then, so let's say this is somewhere around 84, 85 maybe?
Got it. To me it sounds like, and again, I wasn't there, but I'm kind of obsessed with it. It sounds like a downtown version of Studio 54, like as in mixed, as in, you know, a cooler, more edgy version of Studio 54. Is that safe to say, or?
Yeah, I guess so. I think in hindsight, Studio is so glam because so many of those people became super famous and wealthy and fabulous people that were hanging out there, but they were still pretty edgy in the beginning.
Yeah.
I guess it was. I mean, it was certainly a downtown sensation.
Yeah.
There would be a sea of people outside.
Amazing.
Sea. I love that. And I definitely, I think it's there that I absorbed, you know, what makes an incredible party is a curated door.
Yeah.
You curate the people.
Yeah.
And the mix is what's interesting. When you have too much of any one thing, it's boring.
I can relate.
I wish I could read the comments. I put my reading glasses on it to tell me if it's a disaster. I really want to read the comments.
Bill Spector's on. Go
How's that? Can I do this?
Yeah, it's fine. It's fine. Wait, so crazy like
this. Without them, though, right?
I mean, listen, I'll read the comments for you, whatever you want. You're the queen. Okay, so area is amazing. And then.
Wait, are you guys all saying yes, it was cuter without the glasses now that I can read?
No, there's always a delay. They're saying, get your glasses. They're saying, keep your glasses on. There's always a delay in the comments. It takes like a full minute before they answer. They're saying, yes, they're cute. They look good. AJ Calloway said they look good. Dante Ross said, area opened in 83.
Goldie, Beth, Mare, Sari, I see you all. Hi.
Allison.
Raven,
says,
hi.
Okay,
Liz.
So. I want to talk because we're.
I'm sorry. This is
fun. Shout out again. I want to get through this. So, how did you get the job at Nell's?
Oh, that's a good story.
Yeah.
So I had taken a year off from college. I was going to Barnard at Columbia, and the reason I'd taken the year off was I had a good job opportunity, and that sort of hit a snag. So I was doing Jean-Michel. So I was doing I'm getting to that, Dante. Let me tell the story.
Take your glasses off. You're doing the comments too much.
I know, but they're so much fun. Okay, right. So here's the deal. I had a kind of crappy job. I was showing apartments for the Milstein brothers on like 94th Street. I was like the little girl chick who showed the apartments. Stupid job. Because my real job I'd lost, but I hadn't really told anybody. I was hanging out. I went to Nell's the first 2 weeks they were open. And it was the wild sensation, but it was kind of a mess, but incredible. And a girlfriend of mine was the cashier. And so one night I went and I was talking to her. And this was in my super pre-looking like Madonna. I looked like a mini, maybe Diane Brill or something. My hair was all up pompadoured. And
no, I've seen the pictures and I was amazed, I have to say, because I didn't know that part of your life.
Yeah. So I remember I was wearing like a crop mink jacket and my hair was all done and like hairsprayed and a whole thing. And I was talking to my friend who was the cashier, and Keith McNally, the owner, said to my friend, "Who's that? Introduce me." And so I met him and he was like, all like, "Oh, what do you think of my club? Isn't it fabulous?" And I was like, "Yeah, but let me tell you the problems with it." And he was like, "What?" I was 20. And I reeled off a list of what he'd done wrong at the door in the first 2 weeks they were open. And he was like, "Who the fuck are you?" And he's like, "Do you want to come in and talk to me about a job?" And I was like, "Well, okay." And then I went home and I thought about it. So I knew he was English and I knew he was pretty eccentric and he'd had some fabulous restaurants and really had a great eye. So I said, "Shaka." So I put on C. Wilson. So I put on, I put together like an outfit and a look and all sorts of things that I thought would intrigue him for our meeting. And I had a lunchbox as a handbag that had these pink and white candy stripes on it and said, "Let's go downtown and go shopping." It was utterly ridiculous. And I packed it with things, including a Martin Amis book called Money that at the time was not in print in America. And I thought that Martin Amis was a big writer in England. I thought this would make me look very interesting to him. So I would accidentally let my lunchbox fall over and fall open and spill out on the table. Okay, so fast forward, I go meet him and he says, "You know, come work for me. What can you do?" And I said, "Oh, I can run the door." And particularly back then, the door was like a sacred position that you had to earn and work your way up and have nightlife experience. I'd never worked anywhere and nobody, you know. And he's like, "Well, we have door people. Like, what else can you do?" I said, "Oh, well, I could host inside." He said, "Well, I have Nell and our partner." And I was like, "Well," and I was like, "I'll bartend." I didn't know how to bartend for shit. And they had these very, speaking of curated, the whole staff at Nell's was incredible and like literally cast in their roles. So most of the bartenders were these spectacular looking older black men who looked like they were from another era with like wax mustaches and they were just incredible. And then like the security guards all looked like male models and the waitress, it was just a whole look. So he started laughing at me when I said I could bartend. And he said, "Well, would you waitress?" And I was like, "Oh, I couldn't possibly do that." I left and I went home. And he said, "Well, you know, stay in touch if you think of anything and whatever." And I went home and I went, I don't know, however you went then to find out how much money you had in the bank. And I had like less than $20, so I couldn't take money out. So I called him up and I was like, "Well, you know, Keith, I was thinking, I guess I could possibly waitress, you know, just until you can move me to the door." Like I was talking out my ass. So I went and I waitressed. And it was funny on a couple levels. The first being that I knew so many of the people that I was, even though I have an insane eye for detail and service, I was a terrible waitress because they'd be like, you know, "Can I get some water or whatever?" I'd be like, "Go get it yourself." But it was people I knew really well. And then now I was sort of entering my full-blown Madonna phase and I would hold the album cover next to me as I would put my makeup and hair. I had the cross and the heart earring and the spike bracelets and the bob. And, you know, like the plaid mini skirt and the combat boots, all of that. And there is a great waitress story about Russell, but you want to know how I ended up at the door, right? That was the question?
Correct. How'd you get the job? Okay.
So I waitressed for a couple of weeks and it was wild. I mean, maybe my second night, my two adjacent tables, one was Mick Jagger and one was Bianca Jagger. and they weren't speaking, obviously, and because it was post-divorce or mid-divorce or whatever. And then, I mean, anybody you could name was in Nels. It was the wildest scene you'd ever seen.
Yep.
And I ended up in W, like all kinds of stuff in 2 weeks of waitressing. So the club's getting hotter and hotter and crazier and crazier. And one night it's, I mean, to the rafters slam. And this is still within the first couple of months that it opened. And Keith comes running into the restaurant area and he grabs me and he says, I need you at the door. And I said, okay, I'll go down to the, I was like, great, I'll go to the locker room. I got to get my coat. It was winter. It was really cold, or it was late fall. And he's like, there's no time. There's no time. And there was a giant security guard standing next to me. And he goes, give me your jacket. And he had this super cool leather motorcycle jacket on. And he was huge. So I threw it on. And all of a sudden, like, my whole look was born because I had this cool oversized motorcycle jacket. Ran to the door and started doing the door with my beloved Michael Smith, who was this older English guy who was hilarious. And my partner in crime and amazing. And that was how I ended up at the door at Nels.
And that's what, like, that's maybe like, I'm going to guess, like 87 or something. Do you know?
86, I think, but maybe 87.
Got it. And
no,
then,
86.
Okay. And then how long?
End of 86.
How long were you at the door at Nels? How many years?
About 2 years, I think.
Okay. And then you're obviously, because what happened, it sounds like to me, you were kind of an it girl, and then you had the door job, then you became probably the girl by having that door job, correct? Then everyone knew you at that point,
it,
right?
It was pretty off the charts.
Yeah,
that's also, not only everybody knew me, but that's where I met everybody.
Yeah.
That's where I met Russell, Lior, LL, Dante, Jill. Jill and Lisa Cooper I knew before. Four-ish, maybe. I mean, but that's Jules. I mean, Belinda, everybody. We were, if I didn't know them already, that's where I knew. Drina, that's where we sort of became really cemented. Yes, and everybody knew me, and it was crazy. And Nels was crazy. I worked 4 nights a week, and I was there the 3 nights I didn't work because you could not bear to miss a night because you never knew what was going to happen. And so many people that I became friends with later, I used to take care of at the door. And sometimes I'll be at a, even now I could be at a dinner party and somebody starts telling some story. And then they're like, somebody looks at me and they're like, oh my God, you're that Jessica from Nels. And I never know if they're going to be like, you were such a fucking bitch, or you were amazing. You made my 20s. Like, it's all very funny.
Listen, it's a two-sided coin, right?
Mm-hmm.
First of all, did you ever meet Madonna?
No, not really. I saw her more at Danceteria and hanging out with Jellybean, and I knew Jellybean pretty well, but I never really met her.
And did you become friends with Keith Haring?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. I'd say about, remember the picture I sent you? You're like, where'd you get it from? I think that you posted it probably about 4 years ago, and I don't know this part of you. I only know you as, you know.
I know where that picture was from. That picture was from the club that I ran after, and the reason why I left Nels.
Got it. So what?
But there's so many good Nels stories. We should stay here for a minute.
Okay, so tell me some. What?
Well, the way I met Russell was when I was still a waitress.
Yep.
And one night he came in, and it was Russell and his girlfriend Cassandra, and yes, Belito Dante, but we're not there yet. And Sal from the Fever. And whoever he was with. So, you know, Sal's got a satin jacket on. Like, they look crazy. They don't look like anybody else in the club. And you've got every type of person in the club. You've got Andy Warhol. You've got Jean-Michel. You have Naomi Campbell, Christy Turlington. You have, like, Bret Easton Ellis, Morgan Entrekin. Like, every type of person, but nobody that looks like Russell and Sal. And so they come in and they want a table in the restaurant area. And everybody's like, that's that Run DMC guy. Nobody even knew Russell's name. They were just like, that's that Run DMC guy, da, da, da. And the waitress who had the table, I was like, can I have that table? And she was like, yeah, okay, less work for me. So I go over the table, and keep in mind, I'm in full-fledged Madonna mode, like in terms of look.
Okay.
And attitude for days. So I go over the table.
Something's never changed, by the way. Something's never changed, by the way.
Yeah. And Russell kind of looks me up and down, like, what's up with you? And he's looking at the menu, and the menu is pretty fancy for a club, nightclub menu, and it's made, but you know, these English people put it together, and so there's like a lamb sandwich with leeks on it, and the white pizza, and you know, all these different things. So he's like, crazy shit. So finally, pizza. He says, well, how's the pizza? I said, well, I don't know. I don't eat cheese. But, you know, everybody who orders it really likes it. And he was like, all right, whatever. And so he's like, I'll have that. So it's a white pizza. There's no tomato sauce, right? It's like a four cheese white pizza. So it comes out and they bring it to him. And he calls me over. He's like, yo, come over here. And I was like, what? And he's like, what's the matter with the fucking pizza? There's no tomato sauce. And I looked at him. I put my hand on his hip and I was like, you be illin'? He was like, yo, who the fuck are you? And that's how we became friends.
Oh, that's a great, good story.
And then at the door was just wild. I mean, it was wild. Like, people would lose their minds to come in that club and stand outside for hours, no matter what we told them or what I told them. And it was very, I stood on a little box and I pointed at people and, you know, a lot of high, that's the point. You would have loved me then. My outfits were like Gautier and Yoji and I was ridiculous.
Amazing. No,
because the perks were insane. So we could not take money. Yeah. I mean, if we took a dollar and they found out, you were fired. And we would be offered so much money. At the time, it seemed like so much money. And I never, ever took a bribe. But of course, we could have enjoyed the perks. So there was, you know, clothes and restaurants and drinks and this and that. And I mean, I would go on vacation. I could be sitting in a cafe in Paris and people would point at me. I'd be like, that's the girl from Nels. It was wild, wild, wild.
I have a Jay-Z story. I was doing the door at Cheetah on a Monday, and I went to London the next day. He had been there that Monday night, and he was becoming a big star. And the next day, we were both in London, and he said the same thing. He's like, door guy from Cheetah, what's up? In London. Like, 12 hours later, I'm like, what? I said, he's like, what are you doing here? And I said, you're the only one that can go to London?
Yeah, what are you doing here?
Okay, what are any other crazy Nell stories? Or, like, you know?
I mean, there's hundreds of them. I almost got run over by a Ferrari.
On purpose or?
Yeah, on purpose. But we later became friends because it was, Arturo who did the famous, you know, the bull sculpture down in Wall Street. But one night I didn't let him in. And so he got in his Ferrari. And so it's even the same now at Up and Down. The front door like has a little inset. So if you were leaning against the front door, you're like flush with the wall, you're not out on the sidewalk.
Yep.
So he literally drove up and drove through the stanchions and tried to run me over, but I got to step back into that thing. But he later apologized and sent me a lot of flowers. I got hate mail, I got love letters. Yeah. It was super fun. It was crazy.
What was your?
I don't think I realized how crazy it was. You know, like, and the thing is, the first year that I ran the door, everybody paid. Didn't matter who you were. So the thing was to get in. It wasn't to be comped.
Yeah.
It's such a different sort of meter than now. I mean, Cher was paying. Andy Warhol was paying. Everybody paid. $5 on the weekday, $10 on the weekends.
Amazing. What was your door kind of like? Policy, your personal door policy, like who got in?
Oh, well, so as I mentioned, I usually ran the door with Michael Smith, and Michael was much older than me, English and gay.
Yeah.
And so we opened at 10 sharp and we would, you know, curate the door, nice mix, beautiful girls, interesting, artistic downtown people, maybe a few money people, some couples, whatever. And then at midnight, both Michael and I would start drinking scotch at the door. And so by about 1 a.m., this is how our door policy went, because then we'd be slammed. And so people would walk up to the ropes, you know, all expectant and whatever. And I'd look at Michael and Michael would look at me and I'd say, well, would you fuck him? He'd be like, no. He's like, would you? And I'd say, no. And then they couldn't get in.
That's amazing.
So that was one way. And then the other way was shoes. We always judge people by the shoes. And even I did interviews with New York Times and all. And that was the other thing that started to be crazy. Nels became such a sensation. The amount of press and radio interviews and articles, it was disproportionate and nuts. So I really, shoes were super important to me. And one of the first people I busted down for not having good shoes was Andre Harrell, my dear Andre Harrell.
Yeah.
So Andre used to come to the ropes and he'd be like, Jessica, Jessica, do you remember me? I used to work with Russell. I just left. I just started this label. It's called Uptown. Da, da, da. I know you did it. And I would be like, yeah, but money, your shoe game. And he was like, what? And I was, and you know, he's like, Jersey. I was like, your shoe game. He's like, hey, I gotta step that up. And that was the beginning of Andre and I becoming great friends.
Okay. Yeah. And he probably stepped up his shoe game, right? He probably did.
Yeah, of course he did. Well, yeah.
He wanted to get in, right?
Yes.
Okay, so then, so you're at Nels, and then what's your next kind of big thing for you after Nels?
I get courted by these Italians who want me to, like, front a club for them. They're going to open it, but they want me to be the front, the face of it. And they were sort of purveyors. I don't know if, you know, they were investors back in Italy and like the production, whatever. Somehow they were purveyors of this design aesthetic called Bolidism. And it was like, so the club was called Bolido. And it was in the old, oh my God, why am I having a brain blank? It was, it had been a famous space on 17th Street. Somebody tell me, what was the name of the...
Dante will know. He's not, like...
It's super old school. Anyway, Bolido opened in the space on 17th Street.
Yeah.
And I had a big contract with them. And no, not Peppermint. And I had a big contract with them. And this is way before the building, guys. Come on. And I had a big contract with them. And I was the front. I cast all and hired all the staff. I had Isaiah do the waitresses' outfits. I mean, it was pretty epic and spectacular. That photo you saw was from New Year's Eve, which was the opening night party.
The one with Lisa and Keith and everyone. That one.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
And that dress I was wearing was a custom-made Angel Estrada dress.
Amazing.
Angel made a whole bunch of dresses for me. There in that era. And anyway, so it was going along sort of swimmingly, and I started, because the whole time I was at Nels, whenever I wasn't at Nels, I was downtown at like Payday or any of the hip hop parties.
Yeah.
And so I started sort of championing hip hop stuff at Bolido, which didn't go over so well with the owners. And I said, oh, I've got this event I want to do. And it was the Stop the Violence benefit with like KRS-One and like 8 million rappers and music industry people. And they basically had a heart attack. And turns out I never signed my contract. And so they used it as an excuse to fire me. So that was the end of Bolido.
Listen, funny how things never change. Nightclubs still have heart attacks when we do that stuff.
Yeah. So I was broke again. And I didn't know... what I was going to do. I was really like freaked out. And, because you know, whatever your paycheck was. And even at that point, I was kind of making a lot of weekly salary. I was spending it all every week.
Yeah.
So I took a job. I was the receptionist at a short lived, but legendary magazine called Egg with Hal Rubinstein. And while I was there at the reception, I got a call one day and it was Andre. And he said, Jessica, I've been trying to find you.
Like,
what up, Dre? And he said, I want you to do this party. And he said, Heavy D just went platinum. It's the first rap album on a major label to go platinum. Now, before everybody chimes in, yes, other rap artists went platinum, but they were on shady labels who didn't do sound scan or accounting or whatever. So Heavy D, Uptown was through MCA. So it was the first official platinum album. He said, I want to do this party. And he starts describing this party he wants to do. I said, Dre, that's a really expensive party. I said, that's like $30,000. This is 1989.
Yeah.
That was a $30,000 party for a hip hop artist in 1989. He goes, I know. I want to do it.
Oh.
Then I want you to do it. And I was like, but I'm the one with the name and the, I'm known down to. Like, and we went back and forth, but I didn't really care then because I didn't think it was like,
you're like, I want to call
it. I was like, okay, cool. Yeah. Whatever. We'll call it Daddy's House. I didn't really care. And the red zone was some shit. It was wild. We didn't know it was going to be that. It was wild. It was short-lived, but it was incredible.
Yep.
We did a lot of people's first performances. We did Cypress Hill's first live performance. We did Naughty by Nature's first performance. Somewhere in here was the building, and I did Jodeci's first live performance there.
Wow.
I'm bad with the timeline. I'm sorry.
That's okay. I mean, listen, it's roughly timeline. We're talking about
right. But the building was the best because it was Clark and Red and Kid Capri.
Amazing. That's amazing. Together? Spinning together?
No, everybody had a night.
Got it. Amazing. Okay, so you're doing Daddy's House. You're doing the building.
Oh, Bill, Nickelbag Lounge. You know what's crazy? Red sent me yesterday. He DM'd me with my Nickelbag Lounge invite. And he was like, look what I found. I was like, holy shit. So Damon, Nickelbag Lounge was this party we did on the third floor. And I love that everybody knows my history better. The building was first before Red Zone. Thank you. Yeah, except then when after Red Zone, the building was still going after we lost Daddy's House, I think, because I went back and did some stuff. But anyway, Nickelbag Lounge, we gave out free joints. And the invite was a nickel bag with a little, this is when we made flyers at Kinko's. And so there was a little cutout card and it was inside the nickel bag and it'll have a little bit of weed and it said Jessica's Nickel Bag Lounge and whatever night it was, you guys know better, and we would pass that out and then they'd come into the party and I had a case and I passed out joints, which think about it was pretty rad back
that's
then
big, yeah
yeah.
And I'm gonna do the timeline for you. That's like 92-ish 92 93. Okay, so
and Bill's telling us yes, I know it was Wednesdays for Daddy's House.
Listen, it was just a great night. Wednesday's one of my favorite nights for parties, by the way. Okay, so then what's the next big thing for you?
I meet Flex.
Okay, well, how'd you guys meet?
Flex comes to, this is the problem with the glasses. Flex comes to Red Zone every week. So before Red Zone got really wild, I used to hang out at the door. It was wild. When it got really wild, I was sort of banished to the upstairs, which was the VIP. But this was early on. And it was, the DJs were mostly, I think Capri, Red, Clark, Triple C. I don't know. Somebody else will chime in. But so Flex used to show up every day, every week at the Ropes. And he'd say, Jessica, do you remember me? My name's Funkmaster Flex. I work with Chuck Chillout. I have a record coming out with this artist named 9MM. And I'd be like, no. And I literally could not remember him from one week to the next. I didn't even recognize him. I don't know what it was. And one week he walked up, said the same thing. Hey, Jessica, do you remember me? You know, my name's Funkmaster. And I was like, yes, as a matter of fact, I do. And he was like, what? And I said, you know what? I'm going to take you out to lunch this week. He was like, what? And I took him to lunch and we went to Jerry's in Soho. He had clearly never been in Soho before. And I literally, once again, talking out my ass, didn't have a plan. I said, I'm going to make you the most famous hip-hop. I just swear to God. I said, I'm going to make you the most famous hip-hop DJ in America. And he was like, okay. And that's how I became his manager.
That's crazy.
I know. But now in hindsight, it really is.
From not remembering him to wanting to change his whole life and career. Right?
And I really, there was no one thing that triggered it that made me think of it.
Yeah.
It was spontaneous in the moment.
That's interesting. Well, you know what? You have a gut that kind of leads you, or you know, something that leads you in a great way. You know, like you're, something's leading you.
Most of the time, not always.
I listen. It all makes sense, you know. Okay, so you start managing Flex, and then how does that go exactly?
The successful. How does it go exactly? That's a big.
I mean, like, in the beginning, was it successful right away? Was it really?
Yeah, it was because I had such a stranglehold on all the hip hop parties downtown and the clubs.
That's true. Who you met. Yeah, right.
Like, it makes sense. It's like, if I'm going to throw the parties, I might as well manage the DJ that's in the parties.
You're right. Yeah.
You know, a lot of people and other DJs were not, and particularly DJs that I had close relationships with, were not so happy with me.
Yeah, of course.
A lot of DJs didn't respect him and knew he was just getting the gigs because of me.
Yeah.
There are definitely other DJs who are technically better. The thing about Flex is he won't lose. So he studied. It's not that he studied the craft of DJing. He studied the art of marketing himself as a DJ. He studied the room, the people, like it was crazy. He was obsessed with it. It was a 24/7 manager artist relationship. We talked at any and all hours, plotting and scheming and figuring out the next thing.
What's your sign?
Capricorn.
Just wondering, what's his sign? Do you know?
No, his birthday's in August.
But he might be a Leo or a Virgo. Just curious.
I don't think he's a Leo. I like Leos.
Just curious. So, okay, so then you're managing him. This is probably like 93, 94. And then when does he start at Hot 97? Is there a big gap?
God. Here we go with the timeline.
Just saying, was it like a year later? I don't really know myself. I'm asking.
Yeah. Let's see. So I would say it's probably 92-ish that I start with Flex. Maybe 93-ish. He's on Hot 97 with a small amount of hours. And he had no following. His following was sort of like Hispanic, excuse me for generalizing, like very uptown, but sort of Spanishy was like kind of what knew him. And it was weird because that wasn't my market and I wanted to really get him known. So I wanted to create a party that was sort of based around him as a marketing tool to really get him known. And that was a party called Mecca that eventually became the tunnel, but it had many steps before it got to the tunnel.
Okay,
it started at the supper club in 92. Actually, I remember the flyer. And here's the crazy shit. The other DJs that for the opening, I have the flyer from the opening night. It was called Mecca. And the other DJs were Drina De Niro and Belinda.
Oh my gosh, amazing. That's amazing. Listen.
Yeah. It's a great flyer. And this is when I was still doing all the artwork and the layouts. It's gold and green and it has like the money pyramid and the eye. I mean, somebody would make some conspiracy Illuminati comments about it, but at the time I just thought the shit looked dope.
Cool, yeah,
and
cool.
It folded three ways. It was crazy. And that was the opening. That was the beginning of Supper Club, which was also wild in its own way. And very cool, like very...
40s,
like,
right?
Downtown, and then like that literally uptown energy. Mm-hmm. So like uptown the label, uptown like uptown style wise and then downtown, like it was fun.
Yeah,
it was exciting.
And that was short-lived, or how was that?
It wasn't super long-lived. Once again, like, freaked out the owners. I know what happened. I started doing another night there. So Mecca was on Sundays and I started doing like R&B Live or R&B Tuesdays or something with Chuck Bone, and we did a father MC party. And like 2,000 people showed up on the block, and you know, that was the end of that. This is what used to happen. Shit would get so popular, it would get shut down. Because unlike now, where a club would be thrilled to have 2,000 people, including many, many famous hip hop artists, back then they were horrified and just, you know, shut you down. And they didn't have to explain themselves.
Yes. I understand very well. Okay, so. Then after,
and I'm still managing. I'm managing Flex, and we're doing other stuff, and we progress. So I moved this party to, oh my God, what was it called, on 24th Street? I got robbed. I got locked. Mar, are you on here? What was the club where we got locked in the basement? Mar, you're on here. You know when they locked us in the basement to steal the money. She's on here. She'll tell me in a second. All right. Anyway, move the party there. No, not USA. Flex. No, before the Grand, USA was separate. Mar, I see you. What was the club? 24th Street. Oh my God. All right, I'm gonna stop. Eugene's. Yes, Mar. Yes. Okay, Eugene's on 24th Street.
That's right, Eugene's. That's right.
And so the Mecca moved there, and it was kind of great and fun. And Biggie started coming, and one night there was a wild fight, wild. And I think like Biggie's boys jumped the bar, but I'm not 100% certain. And it was getting pretty scary. And Mar and I always had cash on us. So we ran downstairs to the basement, which was like the liquor cooler or something, but the owners or managers locked the door. So we were in the freaking liquor cooler. It was cold as shit. With the cash, and we shoved the cash down our pants. And we didn't even know what was going on upstairs. It was so wild. And I don't know. I don't even remember how we got out of there or how it ended up happening. But that was the end of Mecca at Eugene's. And then we moved to the Grand. And the Grand, although I knew him already, the Grand is really at the Grand party is really where I started becoming close friends with Chris Lighty. Just sidebar. But yeah. So then Mecca moved to the Grand, and then I already had a relationship because Flex would play at the Palladium, and we were doing stuff at Palladium sometimes. So I had a relationship with them. Not so much with Peter, but people who were his wife and the other woman who worked there.
Alex Gation. So I moved to New York around that time, and my first Limelight. So now I'm kind of coming,
I skipped my Limelight and Boy George stories and walking the runway topless. That we'll have to do that another episode. I can't fit it all in here.
We might have to do that on this session, just so you know.
No, it's too much. We're back. We're almost in the shiny suit era now.
I know,
was years earlier.
So yeah, I kind of moved to New York around that time. I started working the Limelight with Peter Gation. The Palladium was kind of jumping, and then the infamous tunnel, but you keep going.
Okay. So, and again, still at the same time, concurrent to all these weeklies, I was producing events. Clients, labels. I don't know. EPMD, I did Reasonable Doubt. It was just crazy. There was nobody else to go to.
Yeah.
There wasn't other people really doing this. Yeah. And it was, I knew everybody, so it was, it's like when Dante was talking the other day and he said it was a very small world at the time. So it's like, we all knew each other and we were friends. Like, we hung out. It wasn't like,
yeah.
I don't know, like, let's say there's a rock star. It's not like he knows all the people that go to the club where he hangs out.
Yeah.
And the people run the label. Like, we all knew each other. It was just tight.
Yeah.
So let's see, I'm skipping so much, but gotta keep me on course. So we go to the Grand, and it's pretty successful at the Grand, and then and I think I'm doing some other stuff at the Grand too at the same time, not sure. And then they start courting me and say, hey, we're opening this place called Tunnel. It wasn't really open yet, and they were like, what do you think? And I had a relationship with them because of Palladium, and I was doing stuff at Palladium. I did Reasonable Doubt Party at Palladium. I did some of Puffy's Christmas balls at the Palladium. Anyway, so
how was the Reasonable Doubt Party?
It was cool. It wasn't like on Smash compared to a lot of other parties I was throwing at the time. It was good, but
well, they were brand new. They were really new.
Yeah, but we all knew him because I knew Damon for a really long time, and he used to tell me, "Oh, I got this guy Jay-Z. He's gonna be the biggest guy ever. I'm gonna sign." Like, he talked to me about him for years before he ever had a record out.
But I don't think because I remember Jay-Z kind of around, like, after that album, he was a slow burn. He didn't like burst in the scene.
Oh, well, not superstar. But again, we're talking, it was a small world. So whatever the hot industry party everybody went to, it wasn't like.
Funny how things never change, right? The same thing.
So.
Okay, hold on. So we have 5 minutes left. Instagram's going to hang up, but we're going to just join again. We're doing a part two. Okay, so in 5 minutes, I'll tell you when it's going to hang up. But everybody watching, we're just going to join right back as it hangs up. Keep going.
All right. Well, so they convinced me to come to the tunnel, but I also try. I do another party at the tunnel too, called A Plus. I think that was a Wednesday again, maybe, and that went for a while. Maybe we started that first, and then I moved the Sunday there. I really can't quite remember the order. I'd have to look at the flyers. And then we started at the tunnel. Sundays at the tunnel, but it was Mecca. It was not, a lot of people say, like, a lot of people in hip-hop who only know hip-hop parties think the tunnel is the name of the Sunday party at the tunnel, because they don't even know the club was the tunnel. They just call it the tunnel. And later, after I left the party, or the party was taken from me, depending on your point of view, it just was the tunnel. But in the beginning, it was Mecca at the tunnel. I have to get some water anyway, and since it's gonna die I'll see you guys in a second. I'm literally about to choke.
Okay.
So I'll see you when this comes back on.
Okay, bye.
Okay.
Bye, guys. We're joining right back. Choking. Be right back. I think we're going to be here a long time tonight, guys, right? Hey, Alma. I think we're going to be here a long time tonight, guys. We have some stories, right? Where's Jessica? So, yes, guys, thank you for joining again. I think we're going to be here a long time. She got some stories, right? So we're just, yeah, she does have a history, correct. So we're just getting to the tunnel, which I can't wait to hear what she has to say about it. Hey, Josie, thank you for joining again. Yes, must see IG, you're right. Hold on, someone just texted me, maybe that's her. Oh, here she is, okay. Okay.
I want you to know, one, I'm fine. I just took a sip of the rosé wrong, and I was trying to keep talking. Everybody's texting me. They're like, are you okay? I'm like, I'm fine. It was
your fault. I know.
I didn't want to be, like, coughing on screen. Two, I was on time to come back in, and it wouldn't let me request. So that was my third time trying. Just want everybody to know.
Listen.
I wasn't being fabulous.
You're punctual. We know that. Your attention is always on point. So, okay. So we're getting to, you know, something very exciting right now. You start the party at the tunnel, the Mecca party at the tunnel. What was the very first night like? Explain to me the very first night.
I'm so appreciative of the fact that you think I can remember.
Oh, God. Well,
you know, okay. one time we did kind of a calculation between my weeklies and special events. This is like probably a decade ago, like how many parties it had been. And we could easily tab more than 6,000 parties. I'm like, how the fuck am I supposed to remember anything? When I meet somebody new and I want to remember them, it's literally like I have to forget somebody old to make space in my brain.
I understand.
For them. I mean, it's just, it's
one
drop
too much. Makes room for a new one. I get it.
Do people come up to you and they're like, oh my God, and they tell you some experience about some particular night and all the details and look at you waiting for like that glint of recognition because you're going to remember that one night. I'm like, you know, for you, it was that one night. For me, it was like one of 6,000. I don't freaking know. Pretty much off the charts from the bat, though. That's what I remember.
Yeah, sure. Because the reality is you'd built it up. It'd been at the third or fourth location. The tunnel was a brand new club. It's a recipe for success, absolutely. You mean the hottest club. You'd built it up.
But, you know, it turned into something that, although everything you're saying is completely true and a recipe for success, it turned into something that the people who came to it and supported it had nothing to do with that downtown formula.
Yes, but...
So, in other words, they didn't give a shit that it was a new club. They didn't care that it had been built at, like, this was just some shit.
Well, the thing is, it was hot. That's why they liked it. They liked it because it was hot. But the reality is, there are other elements that probably did help in that, you know, maybe some downtown people, some famous people were coming because of all that, which only spiced it up, is what I think. But I wasn't there.
Yes, you know. For sure.
You know, like,
but it was wild.
Yeah.
It was wild. And, you know, what's so funny is when people sort of have, if you have a group of people, an eclectic group of people that sort of do a tunnel reminisce thing, everybody's stories are so different because it depended which part of the room you hung out in.
Yeah.
So like this corner was the dancers, this corner was the drug dealers, this corner was uptown, this corner was Brooklyn, got a lot of corners. But you know, there was an upstairs lounge, the unisex bathrooms, the corridor, there were so many different scenes. And then there was the bar scene. You know, and the bar scene was hilarious because this is still before bottle service. But we had like Puff and Jermaine and like all these people would be in there and want to be like balling, but we didn't have like really official definition of how that was done yet.
Yep.
So then they'd want to buy out the bar.
Yep.
And it was hilarious. You know, the rubber buckets that the busboys carry to clear stuff? That's what they'd serve the champagne in. If somebody wanted to buy 10 bottles of champagne, they'd be this fucking dirty rubber, you know, like a tub. And that's what the bottles there were no tables.
Yeah.
You set it on the bar. And then everybody's standing at the bar because this is when everybody drank out of their own bottle of champagne.
Yeah, of course.
So, in the beginning, I used to be out front and at the door and running around. And then it got really crazy. And it changed.
I have a couple questions.
Yes.
How long was the party from tunnel? Tunnel to what? From what year I'm saying, was it 4 years, 5 years? How long was it? Approximately.
A couple years.
Yeah. Right.
I'm sorry, I'm terrible with timeline and date. You know, it ran for at least a year and a half after I left.
Got it.
So.
And how long were you there?
probably the first 2 years.
Okay, got it.
Maybe, but I'm really terrible with this. So
that's
I would have to. I have all the information. Like I just you know.
Yeah, but that's not that long. That's a kind of short. 2 years, not that long. I thought it was longer.
No, it was so big and it was such a game changer and it set the standard for hip hop on Sundays. That's why all the hip hop parties started being on Sunday across the country.
Yes.
And like, that's why Miami started doing hip hop parties on Sunday. It all came from that.
And
there
still
wasn't that before.
To this day, you know, live on Sunday is, you know, like still now 25 years later or whatever.
Right. Well, a lot of the things that I did then, the DJ Collective, somewhere in here, we totally skipped my office and staff and me managing the Flip Squad and all the DJs, but it's too many stories. Keep me focused. So, you know, these were sort of blueprints for the way things were done later as real business. When I was doing them, it was like, you know, you never knew what was going to happen next. I didn't have a big business plan. I wasn't flying by the seat of my pants, but it wasn't some calculated plan.
Yeah.
I have heard people discuss, I've seen it written, whatever, that I had this, you know, grand plan to exploit hip hop, and I didn't know what the fuck I was doing. It was just fun and exciting.
Yeah.
And it just got wilder and wilder. But really, you know, the tunnel was like a blueprint for Liv and Opium and things like that. And, yep. And the Flip Squad was a blueprint for Scam.
Yeah. So what are some, I mean, you know, the tunnel is, or Mecca, let me call it Mecca. Mecca is probably the most important hip hop party of the last three decades or ever, you mean? And what were some of the, I guess, positive things for you, and what were some of the highlights for you?
Well,
were you in charge? Because it seems like, you know, everybody was performing there. Were you in charge of booking or what? Like, what was going on?
So here's the thing. When it was Mecca at the tunnel, there were hardly ever any live performances.
Got it. Okay.
Because don't forget that this was the evolution of the party I created for Flex. So it needed to be all about the DJs. They started booking. And at this point, I was really well known for throwing the party. So in other words, if there was, you know, like Kids Uptown or Brooklyn, oh, it's Jessica's party. Like they knew then it would be a dope hip hop party.
Yeah.
It wasn't, we didn't need to rely on booking an act to promote it.
Yep.
They didn't start consistently weekly booking acts until after I left because they needed the draw.
Got it.
Just saying.
Yeah, I hear you.
So positive things. I mean, it was incredible to see the music and the records and the crowd reaction and the artists. And for me, what I always loved was watching the DJs build excitement in the room. And it was so much fun. So I would, when it got, after a couple of weeks, it was too insane for me to be at the door. And Chris still hadn't come in yet. I'll explain that part in a sec. So I used to sit in the office for the first part of the night. And then I had security come get me and they would walk me through the club. And then I would spend like 2 hours standing in the DJ booth, which was an incredible DJ booth. And it had steps up and it was big and you could see the whole club in all directions from it.
Yep.
But you know, the DJs and the flyers and the promotion, all of that was me.
There's
no sub promoters. There was no, you know, promoters the way it is now.
It was
mine. Yes, there was people who worked for me and people who helped me and people who helped make it happen for sure. But it wasn't the way a nightlife party is done now.
Yes.
And so my DJ lineup, I would have Cypher would open for Riz, who would open for Cap, who would open for Flex. I believe that was the order.
Yeah.
And or Cap would open for Riz. I'm going to get it wrong. And Frank Jugo would be there selling cassette tapes of Flex playing live. And I would get mad at him all the time.
Amazing.
I thought I deserved a cut because they were all my parties. And Flex would, you know, tell me to get Cypher sounds out of the DJ booth because he didn't know who the fuck he was. And all the DJs would get in trouble if they crashed any hot records before Flex got on.
Yep.
And maybe Cap was only on the mic. Maybe it went Cypher, Riz.
It looks like they're saying Cap was on the mic, the comments.
Yeah. Yeah. And there we go. And then once in a while, I would have somebody else come do a set from the Flip Squad. So Bismarcky would DJ sometimes, but they all have to play with Flex.
Yeah.
And they'd do a set. And maybe Doo-Wop did too. But it was Flex's house without a doubt.
Yep.
And, you know, so, I mean, for me, always the most fun was standing in the DJ, and the thrill would always be standing in the DJ booth and watching the room react and the energy build.
Yeah.
And the art of, you know, listen, some people love a DJ for their technical skill, and I respect that. But the art of the party is reading the room and reading the crowd. So it doesn't matter if you're playing for 5 people or 50 people or 500 people. You cannot play for yourself. You have to play for the room.
Absolutely.
And that, I would say, particularly in that time period, was absolutely Flex's talent.
Yeah.
And we talked about it endlessly. What records would react? What was this? What made the bar pop? What made the girls dance? What was the way to make it work?
Yeah.
And
so he became basically a star at that point, right? That's what he became a star at that point. And then are you still close with Puffy and what's going on with Puffy and Biggie and things around that time?
Fun. Exciting.
Yeah.
I'm bringing Biggie up to the radio station with Puff. Puff and I are wilding. We're throwing parties. I'm running around. Like, all our friends are interconnected. I'm hanging. We're running with them. Throwing all kinds of other parties, too.
So you're doing Mecca, but you're also doing other parties during the week? Okay.
Yeah, or special events or other parties and stuff for sure.
So I had started to hear about you around that time. And you had a reputation of being a tough cookie around that time, which I'm sure you know.
That's such a polite way to put it, Damon.
Listen, I know. But you got a reputation for being a tough cookie. And how did you feel about that? Did you, you know, obviously you had to put on this, like, armor to deal with, like, you know, the craziness that was going on there. But did you, how did you feel about that?
It didn't faze me. I mean, because what always came back to me is people would be like, oh, she's such a bitch, but she knows what she's doing.
Okay, good, exactly.
So I was all right with that.
So they're all saying Stressica. How did that name come about?
Andre named me Stressica.
Oh, that's amazing.
Andre gave a lot of people their nicknames, but he named me Stressica. And my company had been called All That Productions. And when, it's a long story, not for today or ever, but it became incorporated under my and Puffy's names. And when I dissolved that, I needed a new company name. And I didn't have one for a while, but my nickname was already Stressica, and people would call me Stress instead of Jess. It was just my name. So we just started saying produced by Stress, and then it became, I was like, shit, I'll just call it Stress Entertainment, and that was that.
Yeah. So it's called Stress, not Stressica, right?
Huh?
It was called Stress
Entertainment was the company based on my nickname being Stressica.
Got it, okay, all right. And then so... after you leave Mecca, I mean, anything else you want to say? Because to me, that's such a pivotal moment in, you know, the history.
The most important thing is it got too wild. And Chris Lighty and I were very good friends, best friends. And I was like, it's out of control and I can't handle the door and I don't have a door person. And I was like, can you come in basically for street cred, you know, and just help me regulate and handle and, you know.
Yeah.
It was funny, like, a lot of people who you'd think wouldn't be cool with me were super cool with me. Like, all the uptown drug dealers loved me because I would scream at them and their crew at the door, and they were just like, who is this crazy little white girl? But they were like, but she's a boss.
Yeah.
So they liked that. But there were other people and shit that I shouldn't have been talking to, and I rubbed them the wrong way. So Chris was, we were really good friends. He understood me, and he was a great balance to me. And when it wasn't okay, or a good look or safe for me to be at the door, he could stay there when we still needed to get people in. And we had a ball just doing it together.
Yeah.
And everybody thinks that he was my business partner and made money off the tunnel. The crazy shit is he just did it for shits and giggles because it was cool. And but first of all, I never made the money that anybody thought I did because my deal was terrible and whatever. So, you know, everybody has their 2 cents. So Flex thinks I didn't pay him much, and this one thinks I was making 30 grand a night. Bottom line is Peter was making all the money.
Yep.
Anyway, but one of the funny things that Chris and I would do, we'd stand at the door and we'd make bets just to pass time. It could be anything, like how many people are on the line, what time is the cops going to show up, what time we're going to get shut down. I mean, when it was Sunday night, the whole West Side Highway would change when you'd start to see people heading to the tunnel. Like from uptown, like it was just the craziest thing. And so we'd make all these crazy bets. And I remember one night, I don't remember the bet, but I lost the bet. And I was so pissed because at the time he had a Land Rover and it was a big bet. And I had to pay for the fucking running boards and rims, which was a big check back then.
Yeah.
But I paid it because, like, he wasn't making any money. So it was like, and I knew, you know, it would come back in kind. But it was so funny. Like, we were just like, what the fuck? Like, standing at the door of this wild, wild club making bets over rent.
And then another question. Why do you think that that party was so kind of successful or crazy? What was it about that party? Was it the timing or what was it, do you think?
Everything. It was the timing. It was the room. It was the first time there was a major, major outlet and venue for that music.
Which was also really emerging
at that. Wait, for that music, I don't mean for hip hop. I mean for that music of that era, because it was a turning point in the music too. Yes. So in other words, it wasn't like, oh, this is Latin Quarter and this is Thugged Out. It was starting to become sexy.
Yeah.
And because of all the parties I had thrown, maybe, or who knows what, we were not specific to a neighborhood. It wasn't an uptown party. It wasn't a Brooklyn party. It wasn't a downtown party. It was just for motherfuckers that loved hip hop. And people were driving. They were driving from Raleigh and North Carolina. Like, it was crazy. And
earlier, somebody used to drive from Detroit to go to that party.
Yeah, yeah, it was really, and you had downtown people, you had real artists, you had backpack artists, you had drug dealers, you had the beginning of the shiny suits, you had gold chains. I mean, it was just fucking everything. Well, it was literally everything matched into this room, and the energy was bonkers.
It also was a big club, first of all. It was not a small club. And also, the music, like you're saying, it was the timing of that music being, like, actually becoming really... Yeah, shifted the music, but these people were becoming kind of real big. They were becoming stars, like right during that time. They were actually becoming these kind of big superstars, and I think that's also probably added to the excitement.
Of course,
you mean.
And I was part of it. You know, I was I was so connected to Puff.
Yeah.
And everybody, so it felt like everybody was along for the ride. I mean, one of the things about hip hop, I think that, you know, has always been true. It's like the artists hang out in the same club as the consumers. It's all, everybody's connected. I don't think it's that way in other musical forms. It's like,
yeah, you're right, you know, that's a good way of looking at it. You're right, that's interesting.
It was exciting.
And then Mary J. Blige probably, you know, was becoming a huge star during that time. Puffy, all that, you know, they're becoming huge, you know, like right those years. So, I mean, that has a lot to do probably with
But again, it still was small. It was huge, but it was still a small world for the art. So, like, we really knew each other.
Yeah.
Like, we were really, like, tight and friends.
Well, y'all came up together. It makes total sense, you know, as real friends.
I had a gun put to my head twice.
At the door?
No, but... like being followed home type of thing. Because again, everybody thought I made so much money, which I didn't.
Yeah.
And if I did make all that money, would I be so stupid as to go home by myself with it in my bag? Like the people who robbed me were really stupid. No, because the manager and security would leave the club with all the cash. They should have been following them. Instead, they followed me. That was, you know, a lot.
I'm sure. Everybody's mentioning Busta.
Yes. Busta, I got to know really at the Red Zone at Daddy's house, and Leaders, and God, so many people.
So who did you connect with? Like, so obviously Andre being this like amazing, kind visionary, Puffy and you kind of connected. Who else did you connect with?
I was really tight with Russell, Andre, Puff, Steve Rifkin, and then artist-wise, it was Q-Tip, it was Buster, Leaders, you know, Charlie Brown, Dinko, at the time, they were always in Red Zone. I'm trying to think, Biggie, Kim.
Yeah.
Lil C's Junior Mafia, because then also Caesar and Junior Mafia were on Entertainment, and that was Un and Jacob, and Jacob was one of my closest friends. And so I was also, I don't know, forgot to mention this, doing independent marketing at the time. So I would get accounts with different artists and do promotions, and I had street teams. I had all kinds of shit. I did the whole AZ street team campaign with his sticker. I don't know. It's a lot. It's a lot.
Okay, so then after you leave Mecca, then you kind of focus on what? Your events?
I guess, who I was still managing and not managing. It took a while. I mean, it was pretty dramatic the fallout between me and Flex.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think. We had done the deal in the first album out loud, I guess. And then, like, when we split up our relationship, because I was the executive producer on his first album. This is bad. I need to write a timeline out and have it, like, as cue cards before I talk.
Well, you know, but the reality, like, I say this to, you know, most people that are, I find as intriguing as you, like, please, are you writing a book? And please do write a book. What's going on with that?
I always wanted to do a documentary more than I wanted to do a
yes,
book.
You should do all.
I wanted visuals and, yeah. And I wanted other people's stories of things that I had created included in it,
yeah.
And referenced and interviews with other people, because I think that so much of what I did was create experiences for people that I want other people's voices in it.
Yeah, that's great.
Unfortunately, this is like the fifth time around, like it's gone several steps in and then goes nowhere. So I don't know how many more times I can be bothered to try.
Well, no,
I've had deals go all the way to like contract and not.
Yeah, don't say that, because it's such an important story that needs to be told, whether it be told through other people's voices, with, you know, through the lens of them, you know, directed by you, whatever.
I agree, but you also have to realize, Damon, that many, many people that are crucial to this story and I would want their voices are no longer alive. And that's like a big thing. So it becomes very skewed, the point of view and who tells it and what it is. So,
well, then just do it yourself. Make sure that you're, you know, 100%, you know, directing the narrative the whole time. You mean?
Yeah, it's not that I can't direct the narrative, but it's like I want their voices, and I miss their voices. What can I tell you? I don't know. We'll see what happens.
Well, Justin, I'll say it one more time. We're going to move on. It's such an important story that needs to be told for generations to come. Like, you know, in 30 years from now, people still need to be hearing these stories. See what I'm saying? It's very important to document it so that people can just know. It's history. It's real history.
I did a bunch of years ago, Reggie, rest in peace, I did Combat Jack's show. And it was a little similar to this in that I had no plans on what I was going to say or talk about.
Yeah.
And I just talked off the cuff literally for 2.5 hours. And it was after that that everybody started freaking out, saying, you really have to do a documentary. And the exact same thing happened to me when I was talking on that. I would feel like I had to cough and my face was getting hot. But anyway, I cannot take this story all the way to present. I will give you a little bit more of the 90s, and then we're wrapping it up and talking about people or something else.
You're the queen. You're driving right now. I'm passenger. Go. So I want to know what's like the gap after the Mecca situation. You're managing DJ still and doing events, correct?
Yes, but it was very, you know, when you're, it doesn't matter who or what it is, when you're deeply, deeply involved with something, let's say it's even a personal relationship and you break up with somebody, you're so sensitive and sensitized to it. It's like, let's say you're going out with somebody and you break up, you're like so aware of every move they're making. Like if your heart's broken and you're so worried about who they're talking to or what do you look like or whatever. That's literally how it felt when Flex and I broke up. I was traumatized.
Got it,
I remember Vibe did his story on the tunnel a couple of years later, a huge piece, many, many pages. And they wanted to interview me. And it was like, even then I was like shaking to talk to them. And I was very protective of the facts. And I didn't really say what happened. It was crazy. Like you felt so self-conscious, and it was like, you know, you just think it's the whole world. Like,
the reality is it just means that you're very passionate and it's very close to you, which is great. That's why you're successful, because you're
successful. Yeah, but in hindsight, the real reality is Flex is getting pressured by his jealous boss, who is the program director at Hot 97. And she didn't want me managing him.
Yeah.
And he thought I wasn't paying him enough money, and he wanted the fucking party. Like, you know, and now I could say that. But then it was like you were terrified and I was afraid. And, you know, people wouldn't work with me. Labels wouldn't work with me because she was trying to blackball me.
Yeah.
And Hot 97, Tracy Clardy, she was trying to blackball me. And she told people, which is totally illegal. She told people, I will not play your record if you use Jessica.
Oh, wow.
How fucked up is that? Now, I don't have a million great things to say about Puff, but one thing I will fucking say is he stood up for me. He hired me, and I did all his events back then because he was like, I don't give a fuck. She's the best at it. And he said the same thing to people who felt he should be hiring somebody else, you know, whether it was somebody black or somebody he grew up with or whatever. He was like, I don't care. That's not what it's about. I want the person that's going to throw the best party. So Puff and Chris really stood by me, and that's also how I was always doing events for Buster and eventually 50 and all that stuff. They really stood by me in those touchy years.
I think Busta might be on here. People keep shouting him out, so he may be on here.
Really?
I think so. I did a party with you for 50 Cent for something. I don't remember what, but...
I can't remember anything.
I remember, I mean, we've worked together in many incarnations over the years, so...
I know, in different...
getting back to you being a tough cookie, you know, I was thinking about that today. I was like, I'm going to interview Jessica. You have this reputation. And when I met you, I thought, wow, she's so cool. She's so nice. She's really smart. She's really, she's actually, you're very witty. You kind of have this really witty sense of humor and you're really smart, but I didn't, you know, I don't see the...
Did I ever yell at you?
You yelled at me a few times. I mean, you know, it didn't go well in either account, but like...
Bill has a great story how I yelled at him in like 94 and he's still traumatized from it.
No, I wasn't traumatized. I think I basically was like as shady as I can get right back. But my thing is that, you know, like you didn't have this bark to me. You were just kind of like, you know, really professional, really together, and really, you're really hardworking actually too. And you're very loyal.
I had so much fucking energy. I don't have that energy.
It's true. You're very loyal though, and you're very together, and you have this really witty sense of humor, which I'm not sure everyone knows about you. You mean?
Somebody just said I yelled at everybody.
Yeah, that's true. I know you had this reputation for yelling, and I met you. I'm like, oh, she's sweet. You know, like, you know, so.
At least, you know, I mean, there was a reason my nickname was Stressica.
Yeah, that's true.
It was like high stress, and the way to deal with it was to yell. But I was also a freaking perfectionist, so I would get very, very upset if I was producing an event or throwing a party somewhere and shit wasn't together. And my attitude, and even if somebody worked for me or somebody was working in the club, my attitude was always like, whatever the fuck you're doing, I've already done it. Like, I put in, I would get mad if I had stuff, because don't forget, when we started promoting, no internet, no whatever. So I had a team and we stuffed flyers in envelopes and sealed them and had to take thousands of envelopes, address them and take thousands of envelopes to the post office every freaking week. Yeah. You know, and people would start to fuck off and get lazy. I'd be like, yo, Mar and I used to stuff every envelope ourselves.
Yeah.
Like, whatever it is you're complaining about, I already did it. So I have the right to like demand you do it well. And I'd start bussing in the club if they weren't cleaning the tables. Like, I hate, like, hospitality service.
But that's what I like about you. First of all, every single comment said that you yelled at everybody. They're just saying that, so everyone said that. But that's what
I am happy to tell you that Stressica's retired, and I rarely yell anymore.
Yes, I don't know Stressica. I only know Jessica. But my thing is, that's what I like about you. I worked with you, and you're the kind of, you just get it done. Where those, I like that. I'm the same way. Like, I don't care what my job is. Get it done. You mean, like, get it done well, so... I like that about you. I'm trying to think. You have now. We've had intense moments over the years, but always always love in the end. Always, obviously. So, and I think that's why people really like you. There's so many people on here. Jason and Noah are on here. So many great people are on here right now because
that's so nice.
Everybody loves you for the same reason. You know, I think that you're extremely passionate. You know, and everyone just loves you. I think, you know, as a result of you being so loyal and so. Devoted to what you've done and did and have, you know, are doing, like you were so devoted to it in that era. And so,
it's true. I really loved it. I really did.
It's obvious. To be honest, I see you now and you still love it. I see it. You do. You still do. I see you enjoying yourself now still. So you mean?
Sometimes. I mean, I don't go, it changes. It goes in waves. I would say the like last 2 years, I really have not enjoyed going out at all. Noah and I have talked about this, like we just can't really stand being in the club.
Well, it's also
obviously not. Has to be more than I do, but like it's different. It's like you're standing there and it's funny, quarantine with all the DJs and the music and MOS and D-Nice, and I've also really enjoyed listening to Questlove. Like, it's made me remember what I loved about it. And it's
absolutely.
Like, I will go out after this.
Yeah.
And it's not going to be the same as before. I'm not going to be like drinking and rock starring on the table, but I feel like I'll enjoy it again because I really miss the music and the people.
Well, a couple of interesting things is that, you know, it's not a creative time, or like you said, the Mecca was so exciting. It's not an exciting time, and it hasn't been for a couple of years.
No, and I basically hate new hip hop. So,
but
there's that.
But that's Alex, by the way, don't get her started. So, but Swizz Beatz said it best about the quarantine. He said, "Isn't it interesting that it all went right back to the DJs? One of the most important things has been the DJs all time, which is so true." And then Lynn Whitfield, the actress, I was talking to her recently, and she said, "Only the authentic and only the real will survive this and flourish, which is exactly the truth. I think 100%. The DJs have become superstars. You know, D-Nice became a superstar over the past 2 months. You mean?
I know.
So I'm glad that that's happening and not these people, you know, taking pictures of themselves in their bathing suits on Instagram. Do you see what I'm saying? So
I know. And you know, all this era that we're talking about, people danced. There was nobody had maybe we had a beeper.
Yeah.
Or you had like a disposable camera or a Polaroid. Like nobody was looking at their shit. You were maybe looking at your two-way pagers were exciting, but I mean, it wasn't, the focus was on the other person and you were present in the moment. That's the difference.
Absolutely.
Nobody is freaking present in the moment anymore. They're worried about what's this going to look like on my social media? What was somebody else's shit on social media? Nobody's there.
Well,
in the room with you. It's crazy.
Yeah, you're right. But the problem with social media is people are getting paid a lot of money now. You know, that's when money came into it, then it's, you know, it's
like bottle service. There's always something new to ruin shit.
You're right.
Well, it has a chance.
I noticed, specifically when Instagram started to become a thing, people stopped coming to my parties and just watching them on Instagram. I'm like, oh my God, I can't, you're just watching it from home. I'm like, it's so annoying. Instead of coming, you mean?
Oh my God. That's hilarious.
I know. Okay, so I want to say a couple things about you. I'm gonna give you an opportunity to say something, but I want to say something about you.
Okay.
I'm so happy to celebrate you for the cultural the importance that you've had on culture. I think that you're one of the most important people, women, for culture in the past 3 decades. And there's a handful of you. You are so important to it, and I want you to appreciate that about yourself and know it, that you really genuinely shifted an entire culture, moved it, and did it with you know, integrity and passion. And as a result, that's why it was so successful. And that's why you had this huge, long, crazy, insane legacy as a result. You mean, so I really want to salute you that way and say that you are so important to culture. So
thank you. I appreciate that very much, Damon. And, you know, I mean, there's so many parts of the story. So there's so many things we didn't talk about. And I had some incredible people who worked for me over the years and amazing, amazing, you know, assistants and staff. And everybody will say that I yelled at them. But everybody will also say that I instilled an incredible work ethic in them. And something that I really love is to see how successful and confident everybody who worked for me is now. You know, like, it's just, it's kind of super cool. Richie and Karima and Karima and Karina, Naima, Jeff Sanchez, like so many people. And that's something I really love. And the DJs and the artists. And I don't know, another day we can talk about J Rose because we really only talked about Stressica. And that was a whole other era.
Well, and, you know, if you want, you know, I want to give you the opportunity to say, you know, you know, what's your focus now? What do you work, you know, like, what do you want to talk about now? Like, what, you know, what's your...
Well, I mean, to be honest, the last couple of years, I have not been managing anybody. I think I really, you know, I was just tired. I got really tired. I got tired of taking care of people. I got tired of fixing other people's things.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's a point where you're a little too old to be in the club all the time. And I really stretched that as long as I could. and, you know, unfortunately, because clubs can hire the artists and they pay the artists now rather than the label paying to have the artist party and whatever, the relevance of me producing events in the clubs pretty much faded. You know, private parties, it's just not the same. So occasionally I still do something, but not really. I do buy Storm's party every year because Mark was Biggie's manager and they're loyal to me. But in general, I just, you know, I haven't been doing much of that. I have off and on, I guess, since like 2000 and I don't know, very early. Cocktails with Jessica. I do always do a limited run when somewhere comes up.
People are shouting that out now saying they love Cocktails with Jessica, which is a great title, first of all.
Yeah, I need, and a lot of people stole that. you know, yeah. and all of a sudden they have cocktails, but that's another story. I need a space to do cocktails, maybe in the fall or something. So anybody have anything? you know, well, and I like it because I play all the 90s stuff that I love. But yeah. anyway, the last couple of years I worked for Cipriani. I'm full circle doing the door. Yeah. I'm back right where I started. But you know, it's 3 days a week and I'm off all summer, so it's not too shabby. I don't know what's going to happen after this.
Yeah.
I don't know what's going on. I've been doing some interior design projects, which I've done over the years.
Oh, great.
Most people know, but maybe not everybody knows. I did Puff's house in the Hamptons, despite the fact he went in style and claimed he decorated it himself. But I've done a bunch of projects over the years, and I'm working on something now, so I'm excited about that. Maybe that'll be the avenue. I don't know what's going to happen after this. Yeah. What's going to happen in nightlife.
Well, here's what I think, too, about that. I think that, you know, you're innovative, I'm innovative, we're both creative people. It's gonna be very different, I think, and we're gonna navigate it in the way that you navigated the late 80s and, you know, doing these, you know, doing that kind of stuff. It's to me personally, you know, I've had, you know, what I've done for the past 15 years, it's not, I can't do right now. So like, it's challenged me to be really creative, which actually has been kind of exciting for me. So I think the same thing for you.
This is a great lane that you've carved out too for yourself during quarantine with these legendary chats.
Yeah, well, you know, it gives me a couple of things. First of all, I'm learning the skill of interviewing people to hopefully get a show, but then I get to celebrate these people that have been so influential to me and culture. That's you know, and
really love culture.
I sure do.
I always have.
I probably do. I don't care. I mean, I'm like, I love it. So
yeah.
All right. Anything else you want to mention before we wrap it up? Does anybody have any questions, actually? Let's take a couple questions. We have many people on here that have been saying many things and been yelling at me because I have not been...
I know. And there's so many good times and things. Like, I mean, I think Marilyn's on here. Me and Marilyn and Kim Porter and our crew and the way we used to run around. We had so much fun.
Tell me the Boy George story.
I miss my friends, to be honest, you know? Also, yeah. I miss Kim. I miss Chris.
Yeah.
I can't believe Andre's gone. It's a lot, you know? Yeah, so many people are gone. Yeah. They were so... part of it, like the fabric of it, the flavor of it, that, like, you know, and everybody was really, it was a real community.
Yeah, no, it is really interesting that you know, so many people have passed recently, you know.
All right, I'm gonna have to put my glasses on to see what everybody's saying.
Well, everyone's saying we covered everything. They don't have questions, which is interesting. I thought they have tons of questions. Do you want to tell your Boy George story before we go?
All right, I'm so bad with the timing.
Doesn't matter. You were 18, you were 22. That doesn't matter.
Okay, yes. Yeah, so I was 18 or 20 or something. And Boy George was my neighbor. And we were friends already. And I was friends with this really cute boy from the Upper East Side named Christian. And George loved him, thought he was the hottest thing. And then George was friends with this other couple, Nick and Ellen. And Nick loved me, so we all used to go running around town, which was really, like, strange and weird. And George was always hanging out with Marilyn, blonde Marilyn.
Yeah.
Marilyn. Yep. And that's how the first time I went to Paradise Garage was with Boy George. Can you imagine?
So
all the queens have their fans, and they're all fanning George. That was my first experience at Paradise Garage. I thought that's just what it was like.
I'm jealous.
So one night, and we went out all the time, and... one of the things we used to do all the time is we would pull up to the Limelight right when they were closing, but it was George, and this was at the height of his fame. So they would open. And we went in the Mike Todd room, and for some reason, they had to go, the bartenders weren't there, and we were waiting for the bartenders to come back, and, like, they just didn't show up. So we hopped the bar, and they had, like, you know, the giant oversized bottles of, like, Riuniti on Ice or whatever it was, like, the wine, and we grabbed them in a stack of cups, and then we went out in the main part of the club, like, the bleachers, and George and I walked around the bleachers, and I passed cups to strangers, and he poured them wine. And they're like, holy fuck, Boy George is pouring me wine. And we got busted, and George got 86th from Palladium for a while after that. But we were still allowed. I was allowed in, but he was still allowed at Limelight. And so then Marilyn, had a music career, and he was performing, and he did a performance at, you cannot fathom how this came together, but he had a performance at the Limelight, and there was a long runway from the stage, because I know there had been a fashion show before his performance.
Got it.
They left the runway up, and we were backstage with him, and we'd all gone there together. And I remember this vividly. I was wearing this insane pink satin Norma Kamali outfit. It was a tight waist with a flared out skirt that went to my ankles and a bolero jacket. And I had nothing underneath the bolero jacket.
Sounds amazing.
Pink satin.
Yes.
And Marilyn was performing and there was this runway and George was like, fuck it. And I was like, fuck it. And I went, yes.
Fucking no. I'm glad you shared that.
I'm pretty sure that was before my hip hop days, so.
Obviously. Wait, here's a question. Hold on. They want to know, Alma wants to know, what was the biggest lesson you've learned working in the biz?
Working in the?
In the business.
The biggest lesson? Trust your gut.
Yeah.
For sure, trust your gut. Like, particularly, like, you know, don't set. Listen, of course, if it's big business or big plan or money, you need to have a plan and think it out and whatever. But the sort of second guessing yourself, if you feel something strongly, there's a reason you're feeling it.
Yep. And then what was the craziest thing anyone ever did to get into nails?
God. Well, try and run me over in a Ferrari.
that might be it right there. I'm like,
Julian Schnabel flipped the fuck out on me one night because he waited like 3 minutes because I'd run inside to use the restroom. People were always saying I was going to get fired, but I never did. It's actually, again, full circle. Same thing at Socialista now. Everybody's like, I'm going to call Giuseppe, you're going to get fired. It's like, no, I'm not.
Listen, that's a broken record. I tell them, they said they're going to get me fired. I said, I'm going to get you fired. Where do you work?
Yeah. People just brought me crazy shit. Gifts and crazy stuff. I can't... But I think the Nell situation was like, it was so intimidating to people and so important. And I think that I was so, I don't know. I don't think people now, I think I'm more approachable now than I was then.
Well, that's good. Okay, Crazy Leg said, who's your favorite Pioneer rapper that you've dealt with?
Favorite Pioneer rapper that I dealt with? There's a lot. I love Biz because I love Biz. Like, we're friends.
Yeah.
I love Dougie Fresh.
Yeah, me too.
You know, I did stuff for, like, Big Daddy Kane and Eric B and Rakim and EPMD, but I wasn't really, like, didn't really know them well.
Yeah.
You know what? Guru and Premier. I did a lot of stuff with them and I loved them. Still obviously love Premier. Drez from Black Sheep I loved. Q-Tip. So a lot of people. I mean, I go on and on, you know.
Wait, so
honestly, cool. Everybody that I knew, like, I was really cool with, I gotta say. Yeah. Like, I didn't have all the, this was the thing. A lot of people had issue with me. Industry people sometimes would have issue, but I was always cool with the artists. So I think that that's also a big part of my success. I think they knew I respected them, and I often fought for them on their behalf. Like, if I was fighting to make sure the party was dope, it was because it was their shit. And I think that that made them feel really good, and they liked that. So that was true with me and Buster for sure. I always fought to make sure his shit was dope. And
Who, like, you know, from any of those eras, are you still, like, friends with? Are you friends with anybody, like, you know, who are you cool with still to this day from any of the eras, 80s,
90s? Q-Tip and Buster for sure, huge hugs. And, you know, if I see them, we don't chat all the time. But super cool. A lot of the DJs I'm super cool with. I know that I don't like this because it makes me think I'm leaving out somebody I talk to all the time or I love. I don't know.
That's all right.
It's pretty, I would say one thing that's really evident is that my memory is pretty crappy.
Right.
From this talk, so I'm just afraid of leaving out somebody that's important to me.
You've dealt with a lot of people. I tell people when I don't remember them, and they get really pissed. I usually try to be real polite about it, and they go, "Oh, you don't remember nobody." I say, "How many people did you meet this week?" 25. Well, I met probably 400 and times that times four, you know, 4 weeks. And like, I put it in perspective for them.
I used to try and be polite when people would say that to come up to me. And one of the things I hate is they're like, when people try and quiz you and they're like, what's my name? You don't remember me, right? Yeah. And, you know, I used to try and be polite or ha-ha. And now I'm just like, no, I'm sorry. Can you tell me? Like, what are you accomplishing by challenging me? Like, just either tell me.
Always keeping it real. Okay, we'll take one or two more questions. Favorite venue ever?
That's a good one. Well, I love a square room. You know, it's great for the energy. I love, everybody has to be able to see the dance floor because that's where the energy emanates from. So I don't like any of the clubs that have like two rooms, extra rooms.
Yeah, me too.
Except Nels. Nels defied all the rules.
Well, Nels has a certain energy in that room. It's just a certain energy.
Yeah, but it was two floors and both floors were split up. So it didn't make any sense, but it worked.
Right. James Cruz wants to know, what is the best personal and legendary birthday party story?
Oh, James is cueing me. Probably my birthday party in Miami at Liquid that Chris Pacello and Ingrid hosted and Puffy hosted and Flex DJ'd.
That sounds amazing. That sounds amazing.
Yeah, it was pretty amazing. And there are many different details to the story. One of which is a long story that includes towards the end of the party where Puff said he didn't think that I was having enough fun. And as I was sort of refuting his commentary while I was speaking, he threw a tab of acid in my mouth. And then he left. And I ended up hanging out with his security, with Uncle Paulie and James, and he gave us his platinum card and or gold card, whatever it was at the time. It was a big deal. Nobody had black cards yet. And that's a whole story. I don't know about the cue for that. But the party and the pictures from Liquid that night were incredible. Bill was there for sure. James was there.
Noah said he was in college, but he snuck in. Noah said he was in college, but he snuck in.
Excellent. Oh, my God. And then, Noah, you saw Bill or I posted it recently, the Miami Super Bowl flyer. We have, like, Jay-Z and all these people on there hosting.
Amazing.
It was, like, 93. I don't know. It was so many joints. What can I tell you? Lay out cue cards next time, maybe.
One more question. Then we're officially almost talking for 2 hours now, so we're going to wrap it up. AJ Calloway said, do you think Nightlife will ever come back?
Of course it will. Of course it will. Because it is human nature, and particularly New Yorkers' nature. You know, but there is an element of the population that loves that community and that energy of people. Like I always say, like when I stayed promoting really late in the game, like when I was doing Greenhouse and stuff, and people would come and they'd complain and they'd say, oh, it's not the way it used to be. You know, shut up. Then you can stay home. Because the thing is, everything is relative, right? So for the 20-year-old who is out and Buster's on the mic or Who Kid was DJing or whatever was going on at Greenhouse, this was the dopest shit ever.
I agree 100%.
Because it's relative. So, of course, it may be a new version. There'll be a new normal, whatever that means. Yeah. But, you know, it's like, of course there'll be nightlife. It's just going to be different. And is it going to be a situation that might be, you know, that works for me or you? I don't know.
Yeah.
But of course it will. And I firmly believe that the first people who are going to figure it out are going to be Jason and Noah.
Yeah.
From a business point of view, I have no doubt.
They already haven't figured it out. Trust me, right?
I'm sure there's something else. No, I want to have a wine bar with like a DJ booth and just have them play all the joints I want to hear.
Yeah. Some little small.
Something like that.
With a small little bar and great music, right?
Yes. And maybe an outdoor courtyard or something.
Yeah. Something like Lucky Strike vibe with a courtyard or something, right? What about a restaurant? Would you do a restaurant?
I would. Just has to be. I would love to do a restaurant. I'm a super foodie. I cook a lot. It would have to be organic. I'm obsessed with food. I'm obsessed with service and hospitality. I'd want the right partner for a restaurant. Restaurants are a lot of work.
I know they are. Well, you should do a lot.
It consumes you and becomes your whole life. But I would do that because, you know, I can't really be in the club.
Well, this might be a good time. to a lounge that has food. You know, small
lounge. No lounge for me.
No,
I don't want to. I want to visit the club. I don't want to feel like I own the club.
All right. Then do a restaurant, a cool restaurant that's kind of music based, a music, you know, music oriented restaurant.
Why are people in here talking about Soho's is trash? What's going on? Stress room. All right. No, stress room. Stressica's retired. Like J Bar, I think it'd be called, or something like that. I don't know. Hi, Reach. I just want to stand here and shout people out. That's
shout people out now, and then we're going to end this in like 2 minutes, okay? Shout them out.
Curtis.
Go. Curtis, we love you. I talked to most of these people today, actually. I talked to Curtis today.
Bill, don't take my fam.
Bill,
Junior, you've been on here the whole time?
Yes. Junior's doing it on Saturday. He's doing it on Saturday.
Oh, yay. I'll listen. Oh, Lee says she likes the name J-Bar. Okay. Richie, hi, Chandra. Beth, Sonia, we always had this joke. We'd go to a party, and it used to be like J-Rose plus five. And then, like, by the time Noah super hooked me up in Sundance and, like, directors couldn't get into their own party, but I could get in, it would be, like, J-Rose plus 19.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Bert, you're on here? Oh, my goodness. Heather.
Give shout-outs.
Reach. Poochie, my baby, I love you. I saw your text. MOS, wait, I love your live. Please stay on Instagram Live doing sets even after quarantine's over. MOS, please, you have to keep doing
that. He's the one.
The thing is, it's so late on the East Coast. Sometimes I click on and he shouts me out, and then I fall asleep with the Instagram Live on in my bed.
MOS.
Kind of pathetic. Linz, what up? Marilyn, I miss you. Oh, I love the shout outs. This is so fun. Can we just do this another time to shout people? All right. Yes. I love everybody. Thanks, guys. It's really nice.
Thank you, Jessica, again. I want to make sure that you know, receive and feel that I want to celebrate you for, you know,
Lisa, you on here too? And Ross? I'm sorry. I don't mean to interrupt.
Listen, enjoy it, boo.
Crazy legs. Kiss.
People stay for 2 hours. Everyone stay for 2 hours. That usually doesn't happen, so. Thanks. Dante's been on the whole time.
Well, he knows I'd scream at him if he wasn't.
Both fingers on the whole time. Claudine's been on. Everyone's on. You mean so?
All right. Well, I love everybody. I can't wait till this is over. And it made me, one thing I will say is, hey, Red, it really made me, Shanice, it really, Tanya, this is crazy. It really made me remember that I want to be out and see people. I've kind of been shying away from it for the last couple of years, except for work. And it really makes me know I want to hang and be next to people and hear the music and have that. And it was kind of, it's a silver lining maybe of quarantine. Mar, absolutely. I'm really happy you're on here.
Is Mar in here? Mar?
Mar, my Mar.
Yeah. All right, my darling. I love you. I thank you. I appreciate you for everything you've done, but I appreciate that we're friends. I'm so glad we are close friends. And I can't wait to celebrate with you as well. So.
Okay. I miss everybody. Yeah, and this shit better be over because I need to work. I don't have a talk show on here. I need to work. All right. Bye, guys. Thank you.
Love you. Bye, guys. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for watching.
Ooh, it got all sentimental at the end. It was so cute.
Love you. Bye.